And welcome to tonight's book reading session of Preparing for the Day After. Preparing for the Day After is a photojournalistic treatise on disaster mitigation published by me, Malini Shankar, and Walter Keller for the 10th anniversary of the Asian tsunami. Tonight we will study the need for sustainable, integrated and dedicated mass transport systems for agricultural produce and food security in the post-COVID-19 era and how we can contextualize it for Indian needs within the Sustainable Development Goals framework. However, I must clarify that no COVID-related topics are found in the original work published in December 2014. Let us first recap what we have learnt in the previous book reading session before starting tonight's session. Water and sanitation is central to developmental discourse. Culture-sensitive food aid for calamity-struck survivors is critical to ensure no starvation-related deaths in a calamity-struck landscape. Livelihood security based on traditional vocations in deference to agro-meteorological conditions has to be a part of the development paradigm, to be sure. Climate change adaptation, menstrual hygiene products, solid waste management, universal healthcare access, sustainable development goals, they are all factors to be included in the development agenda. Media personnel must be trained in scrutinizing common property resources to publicize disaster preparedness or the lack of it. Renewable energy and inclusive transport infrastructure will be the core of the Sustainable Development Goals focus for India. In a post-COVID-19 era, though, the per capita transport infrastructure should be only 30% of capacity at current levels to make it COVID compatible, which means smaller vehicles like cars are more practical for long distance. For inner city travel, bicycles are winsome in so many ways: healthier, less expensive, climate friendly. So going to work has to be on a bicycle hereafter, unless one is not physically fit to ride a bike or a bicycle. Carpooling is an option for differently abled persons to go to work, or work from home is another sustainable option for differently abled persons for their livelihood security. How about corporate social responsibility initiatives from Indian automobile manufacturers? Sustainable Development Goals requires special automation is made for differently abled users and passengers, or rather drivers, including mobility impaired people, visually challenged people and hearing impaired people. I hope India's automobile manufacturers are listening. Now let's come to target F 2021 of the Sustainable Development Goal for transport, that means for SDG 9 and 11. Substantially enhance international cooperation to developing countries through adequate and sustainable support to complement their national actions for implementation of the present framework by 2030, according to the UNISDR's Sendai 7 campaign, which includes 7 targets for 7 years between 2016 to 22. When I wrote about Meals on Wheels to battle against malnutrition in my picture ebook, Preparing for the Day After, the link of which has been put up in the description box as well as embedded in the video, in 2014, I hardly expected that OBOR will be a reality or a real plan in 2017. Now, what's OBOR? OBOR stands for One Belt, One Road. It's also called the Belt and Road Initiative, proposed by China as a new Silk Route to connect Pakistan's Arabian Sea port of Gwadar to Beijing and even parts of Siberia in Russia. India can and ought to consider an appropriately challenging and ambitious response. Besides, to quote the UNISDR's Sendai 7 target F, it calls for emerging economies to sustainably engage in disaster risk reduction. Transport is literally the montage for that. In the age of global competition and constructive economic initiatives, nothing should stop the dynamic Indian economy, which is aiming at $5 trillion, if I'm right, to complement this vision with an equally dramatic and promising parallel. India should take the lead, political lead, for construction of a multinational consortium to build world-class international highways that will be dedicated to harvesting agricultural, natural resources and commodities trade across South and Southeast Asia. Such a highway network should complement rail and shipping routes from, say, the Persian Gulf to Mumbai, Mumbai to Kolkata, Kolkata to Dhaka, Dhaka to Mandalay, Mandalay to Luang Prabang in Laos, and again Mandalay to Bangkok, Bangkok and to Luang Prabang, Luang Prabang to Phnom Penh in Cambodia, Phnom Penh to Ho Chi Minh City, Ho Chi Minh City to Kuching in Sarawak and Borneo, Malaysia, Kuching to Kota Kinabalu, Kota Kinabalu to Manila in Philippines, Manila to Taipei, Taiwan, Taipei to Tokyo, Tokyo to Petropavlovsk, Kamchatka, Petropavlovsk, Kamchatka to Alaska, Alaska to Portland, Oregon, Portland, Oregon to San Francisco, San Francisco to Los Angeles. From Los Angeles, by train to large parts of North, Central and South America, and by ship to all the Pacific Islands and across the Panama Canal to the Atlantic coast of South America, where ships have to deliver and load resources from all the islands in the Atlantic Ocean. Transatlantic ship traffic has to be coordinated with long-distance intercontinental freight trains across Eurasia and Africa to converge back at the Persian Gulf. This kind of a coordinated railroad and marine intercontinental shipments can augment natural resource management, agriculture, manufacturing, mitigate climate change, and offer livelihood security to millions of people around the world. It would perhaps be the best manifestation of implementation of sustainable development goals, not just that local produce gets more global market access. Secondly, cuisine diversity gets a new meaning and agro-meteorological traditions get documented and will benefit future generations with bio and agro-diverse registries getting automatically filled up. Now that's on the Mekong River. One half of the intercontinental trains have to be grain trains and the other half should be tourist trains to help subsidize the cost of grain transport. Wouldn't that bring the biodiversity link of agro-diversity to the tourists upfront? How about a combined rail, road and maritime route dedicated wholly to agricultural trade, starting from say Mumbai through South Southeast Asia to Manila, and another route from Mumbai to Melbourne in Australia on the lines of say the Trans-Siberian Railway? 50% of the train, if dedicated to agricultural trade, and the other 50% to tourism, becomes ipso facto self-sustaining. Shipping lines can converge to augment terrestrial rail links, which will contribute to boosting agricultural trade, catering to agriculture, fisheries, sericulture, horticulture, and tourism. This will boost investment in infrastructure, augment trade, livelihood, food security, and boost tourism in a very self-sustaining way. In this regard, China has made yeoman progress by creating shipping lines like Maersk. Maersk also has its own railroad. China, being one of the biggest consumers of natural resources and manufacturers, traders and exporters in the world today, almost all international rail and shipping lines are wholly monopolized by Chinese trade. One dedicated agricultural trade train can link up. A connecting ship can link Ho Chi Minh City on the Mekong to Manila. Another branch of the train or the feeder train can connect Mandalay to Mon, Kuala Lumpur, Singapore, Sumatra, right through Indonesia to Papua New Guinea, ship to Darwin in Northern Australia, and onwards to Melbourne by train. Shipping lines connecting Singapore to Kuching, Kota Kinabalu to Manila, with complementing sea lines connecting hubs like Port Blair to Kuala Lumpur, Kuching to Kota Kinabalu, Kota Kinabalu to Manila, will not only augment regional economic ties but defend maritime lines from piracy, migration, illegal fishing and illicit drug cartels. Terrestrial rail link to augment regional agricultural trade from say Banda Aceh to Medan, Riau to Bengkulu to Padang in Sumatra, Bandung, Magelang, Jakarta in Java, Denpasar in Indonesia to Dili in Timor-Leste to Lahad Datu in Sabah, Malaysia, Pontianak in West Kalimantan, Indonesia, and Kuching in Sarawak, Malaysia to Banjarmasin City in South Kalimantan, Borneo, Indonesia, Samarinda City in East Kalimantan to Labuan in Brunei, will augment agricultural trade and food security by husbanding bio and agro-diversity. Complementing but dedicated shipping lines catering solely to agricultural trade can also connect Lakshadweep to Sri Lanka, Minicoy to the Maldives and Makassar in Indonesia, Trincomalee in Sri Lanka to Banda Aceh, Makassar City to Surabaya, Singapore to Kuching, Sorong in West Papua to Taipei and Port Moresby to Manila. Another dedicated ship cum rail network from Mumbai to Kolkata, Kolkata to Dhaka, Mandalay, Mon, Kuala Lumpur, Singapore, Jakarta, Surabaya, Bali, Flores, Delhi and Port Moresby. A train by sea link to Darwin, Brisbane and Melbourne. This network can be complemented by dedicated shipping lines to Micronesia like Vanuatu, Marshall Islands, Tuvalu, Tonga, Bougainville, New Caledonia, New Zealand and French Polynesia. Seoul to Shanghai and by road to Pyongyang can mitigate malnutrition in North Korea. Existing rail networks need to be augmented with signals, standardizing rail gauges, double lining, dedicated carriages, port facilities like freezers, food processing plants, seamless tax regimes, connectivity to agricultural cargo for this line from dedicated ships and so on. Quotas for fresh perishable agricultural cargo will boost the economy infinitely in these ASEAN and South Asian countries. The potential for boosting economic ties is manifold. Employment opportunities and livelihood security, agricultural trade, disaster mitigation, prevention of trafficking, poaching and illegal migration. Surely Interpol will be part of it then. Shipping-dependent island states of French Polynesia and Micronesia in the South Pacific will also be able to buffer gaps in diversity, especially in the day and age of climate change. The sheer biodiversity variety of, say, of a single cereal, like say rice in Indonesia, has the potential to mitigate malnutrition right across the ASEAN countries. Remember Cyclone Pam and the havoc it wrought on islanders in Fiji's and their food security? I think it was in 2013. Other natural resources like natural gas, minerals in these resource-rich countries can do with sustainable exploitation. Mighty navigable rivers like the Mekong, Ganges, Irrawaddy, Sepik in Papua and Kapuas in Kalimantan are perhaps the only navigable rivers that can be sustainably utilized for the economic sustainability of people from all walks of life. The Mahakam River basin contains numerous lakes, producing annual catches of up to 35,000 metric ton of fish catch. This area is the second most productive hydrocarbon basin in Indonesia too, containing nearly 3 billion barrels of oil and 30 trillion cubic feet of gas reserves according to the World Atlas website, the link of which has been put up in the description box below. Inland navigation in rice-rich countries like Thailand, Cambodia, Vietnam, Laos, Indonesia and Sri Lanka will boost agricultural trade and regulate sustainable markets for the manifold varieties of rice alone. Coupled with vegetables, fruits, mushrooms, lentils, pulses, cereals, dairy, cash crops, spices, fish and poultry, the markets for such goods will be robust and can become a game changer for agriculture. Typical agricultural commodities for trade on this train cum ship route must include raw agricultural produce like grain, fruits, vegetables, mushroom, fisheries and seafood, silk produce, textiles, besides processed foods, animal feeds, fertilizers, veterinary medicines, meat, minerals, etc. This will give an infinite boost to tourism too, as resorts, hotels and land transport, employment opportunities to tourist guides, transport providers, translators, writers, photographers and media all gain. Infrastructure like fish landing centers, ports, freezers, warehouses, water and sanitation, healthcare and insurance, maritime police are all strengthened. It is an opportunity for Indian political leadership to lead globally and make a difference in the global challenges that still stare at humanity 7 decades after the empire was humbled by a sheer moral tenacity of a political saint that some call a half-naked fakir, the likes of who has never since strode the planet again. There can be no better colonial revenge for all former colonies in the South, India, that includes India, Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bhutan, Myanmar, Thailand, Malaysia, Indonesia, Singapore, Cambodia, Laos, Vietnam, the Philippines, Hong Kong, Taiwan, Japan, North and South Korea, Papua New Guinea, East Timor, Bougainville, Tonga, Fiji, French Polynesia, and Micronesia. In all these countries, perhaps Thailand was the only country that was never colonized. And then they will prosper constructively with inclusive growth. That should appeal to the nationalistic sentiments of the far-right Hindu nationalistic party in power in India, surely. It also holds the prospect of eliminating terrorism from South and Southeast Asia, since there will be inclusive horizontal economic growth, and it will also reduce the possibility of war in nuclear-powered South Asia. Of course, protective measures need to be taken on the trains and ships against smuggling of wildlife derivatives, trafficking of vulnerable women and children, as also of illicit psychotropic drugs. The trains and ships should not become easy low costs for illegal economy and not burden the overburdened customs and immigration officials everywhere. Eco-sensitive economic development is the key to disaster risk reduction. Inclusive employment generation portends horizontal economic growth and inherently builds resilience in vulnerable communities. For the amount of food and resources we consume at unsustainable levels of today, we need to readapt our lifestyles to leave a sustainable footprint on planet Earth. While grain trains spanning the whole of the Northern Hemisphere are trying to pool resources for sustainable consumption, its benefits must also reach the people in the Southern Hemisphere. Towards that end, auxiliary train routes must be conceived to tailor to the needs of the people in the emerging economies for equitable distribution of wealth and resources towards a more sustainable world, naturally. One such intercontinental train could very well serve the needs of Japan, Taiwan, Philippines, Micronesia, Indonesia, Tonga, Bougainville, Fiji, New Zealand, and Australia, with a lot of interconnecting shipping routes though. Similarly, around the continent train around South America will benefit humanity infinitely. Imagine getting Australian dairy products in India on a weekly basis, or if the Iranians can get access to fresh tomato from India twice a week. Indigenous people in Siberia lack access to fresh green leafy vegetables. This, if supplied regularly from India, Indonesia, and Sri Lanka, will help them beat malnutrition. So that is all for tonight then. In the next week's episode, we shall revisit COVID-compatible architecture and take a look at the need for cross-ventilation in post-COVID architecture. Don't forget to log in for a live interaction around on the 8th of May 2021 around 7:20 p.m. Indian time for a hopefully very interesting interaction. Those of you who have not yet subscribed to our channel, please do subscribe without further delay. I also request you to share the video in your networks and circles. Until next week, keep smiling and keep safe. Ciao!